مرحبا بك يا بروف، وان شاء الله نبدا طوالي.
شكرا مسريم. بسم الله. Hello everybody. Well, first I would like really to salute and congratulate Dr. Mohamed Abbas and his colleagues for this very innovative initiative structuring such an academic forum. And I'm really happy that a lot of the residents and Syrians in the regions and they are attending this. I think this is really a great achievement. I think technology now is the leading thing. And I think you know more technology. So you lead and we'll follow you. First, I think there are three things. The first thing is the internet, I think, because I had a problem actually at home. So I think we need to contact these companies then and all of them, so that this is an important thing. I mean, internet now is not only for business in banks, but I think for academic purposes. And I hear just the vice chancellor of the University of Khartoum dropped the lecturing through the internet because of this reason. So I think this can be done. Electricity, I think this is going to be solved, as I hear that, by end of August. So this is the second thing that before. And the third, which I hope that every resident should have a laptop. And I think the Minister of Higher Education or the council here should make it available for everybody, because people think that, I mean, after this coronavirus, we're going to go back business as usual, lecture rooms. I don't know. So we have to have an alternative. My second suggestion, I think this thing has to continue. And I suggest that we'd have, I know now the residents are sitting for the exam, so they want something probably focused on the exam. This is justified. But it should continue as a journal club once a week at least. And I suggest that two residents can present probably 20 minutes, discussion for 20 minutes, that will be probably 40 minutes each. And the subjects can be from any specialty, whatever you are working, urology, plastic, neuro, whatever it is. The only thing that you need to invite your consultants so that they can enrich the discussion on that subject. The choice of the article can be done from high impact, probably meta-analysis or controlled double-blind placebo-controlled trials, or local, I mean, it doesn't matter. But I think you have to go into this exercise. And I think you have to attend a course on presentation. I think this is important. It is part of your curriculum as well. Well, we'll come to the subject of the diabetic foot or the diabetic septic foot, as people probably call it here. And this article I published actually 1984 in the East African Medical Journal. This is what, after I came from UK in 1979, I worked in Khartoum Teaching Hospital. And I studied 1980-1982, the diabetic foot. As you see, the title, septic foot, because the sepsis was a primary in the etiology. But as you will see in my presentation, the sepsis or the infection should be a complication rather than a basic etiological factor. In this series, there was 80 patients, inpatients. So the amputation rate was 39% and the mortality was 20%. You might ask why people come with advanced sepsis and they refuse to have actual amputation. And there was a concept at that time that I would like to die intact. Don't chop anything from my body. I think this is no longer, I mean, valid. But as I said, when 1984, I was in UK for 1 year doing my research in the diabetic foot in the London Foot Clinic at the Middlesex Hospital for 1 year. And I could see the difference because patients present with neuropathic ulcers. I mean, you can hardly see the advanced sepsis we had. I think this is the difference. So I think there is some justification for calling it septic foot, but because of the international dynamic. Well, look at this slice. This is exactly what we want to avoid. I mean, the whole process of management is to avoid amputation. Look at this. A bilateral amputation, and one above knee, and above all, one is infected. Why? I mean, you do an amputation for somebody who has been suffering from sepsis for months and months, and you end with, and I think there is one problem here. They call diabetic septic foot to be done in the dirty theater or not the clean theater. I think this is acceptable. You have perforated the pancreas, the perforated colon, you do it in the clean theater. I think the main thing in your mind when you are doing an amputation is that this patient should never have upon suffering from substance. It could be a disaster if something like this happens. Well, we come to the talk. The talk will be in four parts. I talk about the etiology of the diabetic foot, the classification, the management, and finally, I'll give you a scenario of some clinical cases and probably a drop into our center in diabetic foot. So in the etiology, you have got two major causes, two moderate causes, and six minor causes. So the whole thing will be 10 causes, okay? The two main causes are peripheral neuropathy and vascular skin. So the other two moderate causes are mechanical vertical loading and the connective tissue change. And the other six factors, I will come to them later. We'll find one of them is the infection. Well, we start with the first, which is the peripheral neuropathy. And it is being described bilateral, distal, symmetrical, polyneuropathy. And as you know, the components of the nerves, the sensory, the motor, and the autonomic. Well, the patient and awareness. I think this is the most important thing. Many of these patients, they come actually wrapping their slippers because very easy they can walk barefooted, especially if it was a hot weather, then you would get probably a big blister like a bear on both feet. Well, the neuropathy, as you can see here, can be tested by 10 gram on a foot. What is a 10 gram on a foot? Well, people, I mean, in the old days, we used to use a pinprick. You remember, pinprick. And I will tell you a joke, I don't know whether it was true or not, but they said there was an epidemic of hepatitis, so now it's the worst in the neurology, and the boss was a professor of neurology doing this pinprick. So it has been abandoned because it's not really helpful, but the 10 grams, they have tried 20, 30, and 40, and 50, and they found that if you don't feel the 10 grams, that means that you are liable to get a neuropathy. This is the importance of it. So the place of this test should be where? As a prophylaxis in patients who don't have actually an ulcer in the medical clinic, and I will come to this later. And the other thing is the vibration, and here 120 ohms, but usually we use a 10 gram of refillment. This should be available in any diabetic clinic. Well, the second is the motor neuropathy. Look at this. This is because the interosseal umbilicals are being denervated. So they are liable to the flexors, long flexors. And this is why you get this. And this configuration changes has got a very adverse effects, as you will see, probably I'll show you some of these changes. This is the most important because as you can see here, this is the base, this is the site of the ulcer because 70% of the weight usually is transmitted at the base of the head metatarsal, okay? So this patient, I mean, should have a prophylactic offloading. Otherwise, you can guarantee he's going to get a keratosis and ultimately he's going to get an ulcer. Well, we'll come to this later on, but as you can see here, one of our present Jabir is you can map the feet and you can actually see that the high pressure areas coincide with the keratosis and with the ulcers. Look at this, hallux valgus, crowding of the toes, flat foot, another hallux valgus. This is important, interdigital fungal infection. I think this is important, especially when you have got crowding in the toes. And this will advise the patients every day with the probably wadu at one time to look at their feet because the insensitivity means that they have to substitute it with their vision. And sometimes they have got a retinopathy, so they have to ask their son or daughter to have a look or by a mirror. I think a daily inspection is very important because a lot of these patients sometimes the ulcer or the sepsis has been discovered by a daughter just saying that you have got some blood in your bed. That is the first time that they realize there was a sore or a prick or whatever it is. So this is easily interdigital. This is really one of the causes of loss of the toes and a hammer toe. Well, I must say that all these pictures, photos we had from the medical clinic, that was 20 years ago. What we did is that any patient coming from the medical outpatient, we examined the feet and we found this. So these are patients are asymptomatic. They are not coming because of their physical, because of their sugar. I'm not blaming the physician. I think it's not the job, but I think any medical clinic must have a podiatrist or a nurse who knows about these food problems. And I think you can do a lot. And I will show you later on when you come to the food care clinic later on. As I said, this is from the medical patient coming for routine visit in a medical clinic, examine their feet, and I think you'll be surprised about the pathology. When we come, we discuss the sensory neuropathy with the, and then the motor neuropathy, and then you come to the autonomic neuropathy. I have got a very soft touch for autonomic neuropathy, and I will show you why. Well, you know that the autonomic neuropathy can affect the heart. You get a prolongation of the RR interval, and these patients are liable to have silent myocardial infarction. And these are the two major effects, anhydrosis. As you see the foot here. In actual fact, as I told you, when I was in Middlesex Hospital in 1984, I did my research degree on the autonomic neuropathy. And I did it on two papers that are actually published in the British Journal of Neurology, Neurosurgery and Psychiatry. And one of them was the quantitative sweat test. I was measuring in diabetic patients with compared to normal, the amount of sweat. That was a very complicated story. And it showed definitely there is dryness. Sometimes they get hyperhidrosis, then they come to anhydrosis. So what is the effect of this in the diabetic foot? Well, two effects. One of them, the sweat has got a bactericidal effect. So it has got some antibacterial aspects. But more important, it is a lubricant. As you can, here's a plantar surface will be dry, you get cracks, and these cracks later on might predispose to an ulcer. And the other effect of the autonomic neuropathy is the charcoal arthropathy. I think this is important. It's not very common in this country, but I think Bisrim has got her thesis in before in charcoal.
Yes, it was. It was about charcoal joint in diabetic foot, yes.
That's right, yeah. And now we have got actually a series of almost 130 with Mr. Obaker. And what is charcoal? I mean, still people are debating about it. There is a French jury. We think this is mainly a central nervous system damage. There is a German jury that is multiple subclinical trauma to an insensitive joint and weight bearing with sensory and autonomic. So you get subluxation, the dislocation. So at that time, when you suspect a charcoal, the patient should be probably offloaded. So Jean Martin described it as a neuropathic osteoarthropathy. There is an autonomic neuropathy. And this is another theory signed by Professor Michael Edmond that the nerve supply to the precapillary sphincter and the arterioles results in arteriovenous shunting. So you get bone rarefaction and resorption, and eventually you get this deformity. So this process, when it is active, if you work on it, then you are going to get this complication. I will come to it later on because I think if you suspect it, then you have to be careful about the charcoal joint. Patient should be offloaded. Usually the differential will be, is it osteomyelitis, is it cellulitis, so we finish with the neuropathy and we come to the limb ischemia, the other main cause of diabetic foot. And as you know, I mean, this is a disease where you get hypertension, you get hypercholesterolemia. And smoking, I think this is where you can really, I mean, we don't allow a smoker to come to our unit in Nigeria. I think it should be very clear. One cigarette or 10 or 20 is the same. Obesity. Well, sedentary life, I think, with this COVID-19 now, sedentary life is becoming mandatory and really a problem. And stress, okay. I think also stress, I mean, the other two lower ones, I think probably are not curable at this moment. Look at this. This is an insensitive foot with ischemia. And just want to bring to you, I mean, if the patient is not diabetic, then he's going to have claudication. I mean, the process will come earlier. But because he's not feeling pain, he just comes with this, my toe got black. Probably the maximum he will be thinking about is that this toe should be amputated, and that's enough. But it's not, the story is longer than that. Wouldn't I realize that, I mean, this is a very major thing affecting his limb. He might end with major amputation. And this is a problem of ischemia. I will probably come to it later on. And I think our weak points here, because there is very little we can do. So we come to the two moderate causes. As I said, we talk about neuropathy and ischemia as the two major causes. And now the mechanical factors and the connective tissue. So the mechanical factors, the vertical load and the horizontal shearing force. Because of this motor neuropathy, the distribution of weight in your foot will be affected. So some areas will be bearing more than others. And this is actually can be measured now. I mean, you can get a walking map. Actually, we have a static one in Jabir. And this will show you exactly. And this should be usually connected with foot care and shoes manufacturing. Connective tissue, this is a force changes. And it actually combined with this mechanical, because not only the vertical load, but the shearing force. I mean, your plantar skin move forwards and backwards. Your plantar skin will be moving forwards and backwards. So if it is stiff, and it is dry because of the autonomic neuropathy, I mean, there is a glycosylation. You know that the hemoglobin A1C is used for monitoring the sugar, but the glycosylation process occurs in all proteins, the keratin and the collagen, which are in the foot. So the keratin will be glycosylated, it will be stiff, it will be labeled for cracks when you are walking, your skin forwards and backwards shearing movement affected, and this is ending with what we call as a clear blister or a hemorrhagic blister, depending on the amount of trauma happening. And this is probably the beginning of the diabetic foot. And probably in this map, you can see here, you will look in the ensemble, because this is what people call it here. You get this keratosis. You can see it here. And then you can see there is a collection inside the, this is why actually the very thing to do is to shave the keratosis. I'm going to show you. So there is a collection here. And this collection either is going to break, or as you can see here, and form an ulcer. Or the other, the weird thing is that it's not going to break and you're going to get osteomyelitis. Well, this is exactly hyperkeratosis. But if you look at this, where is the pointer? Yes, this is swelling here. I mean, this indicates there is something more than just this. You get hyperkeratosis, there is it a cellulitis, is it an osteomyelitis, is it a Jordan joint? And I hope the next video will work. This is video. Okay, that video will show you how to do the shaving actually. In actual fact, in that case, which I think is important, just to, you do is a knife shaving of this, and you end actually with an entry. There will be an ulcer there. There is definitely definite. So I think this patient will definitely need some blood studies. I come to it, you need to see whether this patient has got a systemic sepsis, the ESR, the white cell, the CRP, an X-ray, to exclude osteomyelitis. But as I said, I mean, if it is a possibility always there between osteomyelitis and Charcot, and this patient should be on rest. And if there is an evidence of systemic sepsis, then IV antibiotics. We'll come to this again. Then we come to the other six factors here. You get usually stiffness into the wall of the arterioles, and you get arteriovenous shunt. You get microangiopathy. And I think in the old days, they say diabetic are not labeled for vascular reconstruction because they have got small vessel disease. This is not true. Yes, they can have small vessel disease, but they are amenable actually for major vessels. And I think this theory has been deleted, but I agree that they have more distal atherosclerosis, not like that, but the small vessel. You go to the dorsalis, you'll come to dorsalis, and posterior. And then, we come to the infection. As you see here, infection is coming very remote here. But as you know, I mean, infection is a very major and complete later on. Okay. The fourth is the wound healing defect. I think there is a leukocyte defective opsonization, phagocytosis. Okay. But this is remediable. I mean, if the blood sugar is controlled, the patient will not have a problem. And this is some people when they have elective surgery, say cholecystectomy, they tell you I'm diabetic and they are worried. So if they are controlled, they are supposed to get a very good result. So the wound healing is dependent, I mean, this accusing ulceration and phagocytosis, this is dependent on the blood sugar. So this is controllable. And then you have what's the hematological aspect. There is definitely hypercoagulability and increase in platelet adhesions. And lastly, but not least, a psychological, what I call willful self-neglect. And you see that diabetics, I mean, they are more likely to have sugars. You know, elderly patients, I mean, get them usually. I always tell the patient who told me that her blood sugar was high, she's telling me she's not using sugar at all, to the extent that she's just drinking tea with tahniya. So they don't immediately understand. I mean, you have to be very careful. They think balah, dates, and things like this, or probably fruits they can be, I mean, they can take whatever they like. I think this is, we'll bring us later, we'll talk about the nutritional aspect of this patient. Well, we come to the second, is the management. I will talk about the clinical presentation, classification, and treatment. This is just to map, I mean, clinical presentation. Usually, is it local? I mean, this is just a local foot problem in the toes. Is it a toe threatening? Is it a leg threatening? Or is it life threatening? I think when the patient comes to you as an acute, would like to know their objective is to save the life or to save the limb or to save the toes. I will come to it later. Okay, there are several classifications. That means the oldest classification is the Wagner's. And then you have the University of Texas. And then we have the last one, which is the simple staging system by Michael Edmond and Ellie Foster. I talked to it about it. Well, the Wagner is the oldest. And it's still being used, though there are a lot of, this is the Wagner. Grade one is a superficial also. Grade two, extending to the tendons and to the bones, but no osteomyelitis. Grade three, osteomyelitis. This is a deep ulcer. Grade four, you have gangrene of the toes. And four is the extensive gangrene. And since the criticism are put by Hart, yes, that there is no mention of the ischemia and the degree of sepsis. And so Hart is added in each of the first three to add A or B with ischemia or with without ischemia. Well, I come to the simple staging system. Simple staging system created by Professor Michael Edmond, he's a physician, and the late Ali Foster. Okay, I've got a very soft touch for Ali Foster because she helped us actually. All of our staff in Jabir has been training in college there. So we really, and they have put this a very simple system of classification. What do you call risk factors? These are the five risk factors. The neuropathy, the ischemia, the foot deformity, the callus, and the edema. So what do we mean by a normal foot? The normal foot is the one which doesn't have any of these. I mean, you test a 10 gram on a filament nylon, and it is negative. Ischemia, I think you know that either the pulsation or probably the Doppler will come to it later on, Doppler test, an ankle brachial ratio, which is supposed to be between 0.9 and 1. That is the systolic pressure of the lower limb divided by the systolic pressure of the upper limb, and the normal thing would be 1.1. So if it is 0.5 or below, this is risky, 0.5 to 0.9, this is moderate ischemia, and above 0.9 is supposed to be okay. We'll come to it. The deformity, which we have already talked about. So we look if there is any of the deformities we showed. The callus, if there is any. And swelling. So these are the five risk factors. So if the patient hasn't got this is a normal foot. This is important as we are going to talk about diabetic without foot problems. But the high risk is stage two. High risk if you have got one of those, which you have just mentioned. Any of these will put you as a high risk. And then you have the ulcerated foot. This is a small ulcer, not exceeding 3 centimeters. And then you have got an ulcer with cellulitis. And lastly, you get this necrotic. I mean, this is obvious. Okay. So, what is the treatment? I think what I like about this simple staging system is that it looks as an overview, a very comprehensive look. I mean, you don't just look at the foot. If you are having a diabetic foot, you sit and look at the foot. Please don't forget, first, look at the patient, greet the patient, have 2 or 3 words with the patient before you come and look at his foot. So we have a mechanical control, metabolic control, educational control, vascular, wound control. We'll go over each of these because it's going to probably extend the tendon. Okay, so a normal foot shoe, this is a mechanical factor. I think this is to have a factory. This is, I think this is the most important part. I mean, diabetics should know that their shoes has to be from the front, not should be wide. I mean, if you have steel crowding of the toes before, shouldn't have a very high heel, and should be smooth from inside, and should be aerated in this hot summer, cotton probably socks, and if they purchase, this is a problem if you have got an insensitive foot and you can't purchase your shoes, it's advisable to go in the evening because there will be edema, so it will be swelling. And you'll be very careful because you don't feel the shoe. You ask him, this is all I need, something smaller. It's not British, your measurement. So the measurement of the foot for a diabetic is an exercise that has to be taken carefully. And if you buy a shoe, you're supposed to wear it for 15 minutes, and then 30 minutes. And every time you look at your foot, I mean, don't take it for granted. And if you have got an ulcer, there is a bulky dressing, so we have bought special shoes for that. And as I told you, we'll come to this later. I mean, you need to have this mechanical thing. You have to have an insole. The best is this sulfoxazole, and you have got air casts, and you have got plastic fiber glass. We'll come to this, we'll talk about. But offloading is a very important part of the treatment of especially chronic ulcer. And we have a factory, but it's a bit expensive, actually. We are trying to get some of this stuff from outside. And the shoe will cost a lot. And the problem is that a lot of these pharmacies, they sell what they call a diabetic shoe, which is not made for the Sudan, where you have bought some brick, you have bought nail brick. This is made for Europe and for other people who hasn't got this. And this is the problem. It's one of the causes, actually, of the diabetic foot people wearing shoes, because the shoes here is supposed to be from outside, is not penetrable by any object, especially the nails. But inside it has to be soft. And before you wear it, every time you have to make your hand inside to make sure there is no small objects there. Well, the metabolic control is important because any diabetic who comes, you must, as I said, you know, check for the A1C, and you have to check for blood pressure, hypertension, and the hyperlipidemia, smoking. I think you have to also, sometimes you might have a physician as we have in there, so the patient can be seen by the physician on the outside. Anemia, I think you have to check the hemoglobin because these patients on wound dressing, sometimes you discover their hemoglobin is very low. And many patients, we send them actually to just have blood transfusion. And you have to be very careful about this when you are assessing the patient. If the patient is having frequent blood transfusion, be careful that it's not due to renal dysfunction or cardiac. If you have got a bilateral edema or a unilateral. A unilateral edema with a swelling, okay, this could be good. But a bilateral edema, either a cardiac or a renal. And must salute to Dr. Muhammad Harun, who did a very good work, the relation between diabetic and renal. Once you have renal impairment, then is a high risk for amputation. The combination is bad because, I mean, if you have got a sepsis, antibiotics affects the kidneys and both side effects. Okay. So you have to be careful about this combination. But I think it is a whole holistic approach to the patient. Okay? Educational control. I think this is important. Talk to the patient, pamphlets, TVs, news, especially I think in the region. People listen to the radio. I think the Sudanese people listen to the radio. I had the advantage actually during the last 2 months because my TV is not working, so I have to listen to the radio. And I find it really, I mean, very, very, very informative. And I like these actually messages about the COVID. I put COVID here because there is a lot of concentration on COVID now, and it's put in different language for everybody. So I hope on the diabetic, we can advise the diabetic on shoes and foot care and something like this. And I would like really to see these chaps who are doing these small sketches. Very, very, very attractive, very nice. And I think don't underestimate these things, I think, because people don't read or write. But if they have it in this sort of songs and things like this, it is important. This is a very good work, again, done by something. If you have ischemia, if you have neuropathy, you might not have an injury to the foot. And as you can see in this slide here, very interesting because those patients who had, this is a blister, almost 30% of the patient has got a blister. And this blister is usually initiated from a pressure, either by a shoe or by a heat. And look at the other. Thing, nail, I mean, and only 22% they don't know the cause of the ulcer. But the rest, needle prick, stone prick, sharp injuries. And this is what I'm saying, that if the patient can avoid this, they can avoid the diabetic foot. Yeah? 80% of the patient has what? A direct inflicting cause. In actual fact, this project now, we are doing it in all the Arab countries. Just please report the neuropathy, report the ischemia, but at the end of the day, would like to see the direct inflicting causes. And I think first aid should be available. I mean, this simple thing, if you have both, especially cutting the nails, one of the commonest causes, I think it shouldn't be done by the patient. I mean, you have both the first care, they can come to Jabir and put this in a far away from the diabetic foot, so that some patients psychologically don't like it. But anyway, you should have this at home. Because whenever you cut nail, whenever you just, I mean, people now are using disinfectants because of the COVID, and I think this is a good message for us because availability is important. When we come to the vascular, this is, I think, our weak point here because we have got only two vascular surgeons and three probably radiologists who can go and do fast. Okay, how do you, if you don't feel the pulses, in a patient who hasn't got, I mean, if it is septic and edematous, you won't be able, definitely. Here we need definitely to have pressure index, ABI index, as I said, by the doctor. But I mean, for ordinary people, you can test if you feel the dorsalis pedis posterior tibia pulsations. Then this is most likely is a good thing. It will be a problem if you feel them, and in spite of that, in absence of sepsis, you have a toe ganglion, dry ganglion. That means it's a small disease. And as I said, if you have got an ABI index below 0.5, this is risky. Sometimes you get a high. As I said, the normal is up to 1.1. But if you're 1.5, that means this is Mockingbird calcification. You know, the intima, the media, and the fissure. So it's a media calcification, which occurs usually in this autonomic world. It will give you a high force rate. So you can have an intimate acidosclerosis and a media calcification, Mockingbird. Well, this is a transcutaneous oxygen tension is more accurate. We don't have it actually. And the toe pressure, this is, I mean, ABI index is not considered as the best. The best will be either a toe pressure or, and we hope to introduce this. This is the Doppler, as I said, I mentioned it before. And this is the machine, it's a simple machine and you can do this test. Well, this is a study which done here, Muhammad Salah, we just collected that by four. They did angioplasty 77 patients, percutaneous transluminal balloon angioplasty. And as you can see, the amputation rate, major amputation was 30%. So they have success. I mean, you get definitely, the problem with this patient when they come with ischemia, it is a very expensive procedure. As in CT, I don't order CT angiography because I can diagnose, I mean, from this. So a CT angiography will be ordered by the vascular surgeon or the radiologist there, I think. they going to assess. But as I said, I mean, the problem is that if you're going to have an angioplasty, it costs you a lot of money. Because it's done on private basis only, over 100,000. So we usually tell the patient, I mean, this is a procedure that is very expensive. The outcome we cannot guarantee. You might, I mean, come for an amputation, or you might have a less, I mean, a probably two amputation, or you might have a successful, I mean. And this has to be done individually by the other departments, because we want to cause some problems if you send the patient without really giving him full information. And as you say, I mean, the pulsatile wave of the artery is different, I mean, because of the stiffness. You don't have this downward deflection. This is just an example of some occluded. You can see this is a superficial femoral. There is a balloon done here. And then an angioplasty stenting. This is a major disease. This is the same here. You can see this is the aorta, the common aleate. Yes. This is completely occluded. So now you can see they have angioplasty and stenting. So I think the vascular, there is a place for it. When we come to the wound control, and as I said, you either have an uninfected neuropathic ulcer, as the one I showed you, but probably that was, has got some sense. I mean, the majority of these patients, you might find just the colors that you can shave it, and usually you don't get any bleeding. And usually this is needs some shoe offloading, and the majority of these patients, I mean, they do wear, or is it a septic ulcer? In the upper one, if it is a local sepsis, probably oral antibiotics might be. But if you come to the, I think this is important. If your patient comes to you, usually you find that the foot is down being wrapped. You don't see the foot. But I think if you expose the two legs, there are three important signs. Swollen, tender, and warm. If you have this is definitely a systemic infection. That means you have got a cellulitis, you have got definitely some sort. And this patient will definitely need two things: surgical debridement and an IV antibiotics for 3 days until your culture. I think this is, and sometimes you get, if this is settling, you might find the tenderness just on the medial side, indicating phlebitis or lymphadenitis. They're very important, but warm, I mean, compare the two legs. And this is going to give you a very important information. Type wound control. What do we need? Actually, to be frank, we are using tap water. And we have got bacteriological assessment. And this has been going for a long time, in 15 years. We are not using for dressing any of normal saline, which used to be before. And this is based, I mean, there is studies, I mean, this, my reference on this actually is Professor Hiriski, United States, is a microbiologist, is an international known. And I didn't find any problem in using tap water. What about other things? Povidone, I think 10%, I think it's not bad, but the problem is that it tainted the ulcer, and it makes it difficult for you sometimes to diagnose a clean granulation. Besides, people sometimes they put a lot of it, but it has got an absorption, it might affect the thyroid in a country where endemic coating is very common. The other two, the hydrocolloids, alginase, definitely has got a role, but they are expensive. So be careful about prescribing, at least just see the price. The last one is honey. Actually, we had a study of Tekin Siddiq, and this is the late Professor Sarraj in Veterinary College did this study with us. And now it's being manufactured here in a governmental place. And it's got very good effect. I use it a lot, the wax sort of. It's very good actually in an oozy wound. So we are talking here about probably healing. We don't use local antibiotics, please. Local antibiotics has no effect, and they're going just to cause resistance. I know a lot of the nurses, sometimes they put gentamicin, like in icing, shooting. It has no role. So please don't do this. But important is to do bacteriological culture. Not be available, but I think if the patient is responding to the antibiotics you're giving, you can continue it because it might not be unless you have a really good bacterial culture. And here you don't take the positive. This is important. People are now taking tissues or bones. I mean, if you have got an ulcer, it's body. Don't take superficial swab. This cotton swab is useless. What we do is that we put an artery forceps and get tissues from the deep and we put it in the swab and send it for culture. Well, larva therapy, actually one of my registrar, I don't know how much he started with this, I don't know why it stopped. But larva therapy or magus therapy can be used, but it depends. I mean, here probably patients might not accept this psychologically, but it's very good actually. You put this maggot, which is very just embryos, and they get fat, they eat just a necrotic tissue, they leave a very nice graduation. Growth factors. Actually, I did 1.5 years in the United States in Kentucky. I worked on the epidermal growth factor using a PCR. That was pure lab work. You know, other fit transformation, the mesophilic growth factors and the vascular and the cellular growth factor. But I worked in the epidermal growth factors. And actually, later on, it was manufactured as a paste. Very expensive. But I think before you prescribe it, you need to assess the wounds. I mean, we have been assessing these wounds. Some of them have got deficiency in the epidermal growth factors. I don't think it's available here. It doesn't put a lot of reputation. Skin graft. Yes, we had a very nice publication. Actually, it has been quoted many times, I'll show you later on. I mean, people here are probably reluctant about having skin graft. I mean, they think you're going to take a wound, make a wound. But I think in certain wounds, it is, I think, important. But I will tell you how can you probably do as much as to avoid probably skin graft. Hyperbaric oxygen, it has got a reputation, but I think now people have local oxygen. And the problem is that the hyperbaric oxygen should be available in a setup. I mean, comprehensive. I mean, patients, they go sometimes without, they need debridement. And they shouldn't go for hyperbaric. So this is, you are talking about an ulcer non-healing. And we have got actually a publication again of wound care about ulcers up to 6 months. Has been a good way. Now we are working in ulcers exceeding, I think, around 4 or 5 years. I think we have put around 50 patients in this category. But skin graft, I think, has got a place. We are trying actually to avail this hyperbaric, local oxygen in our center. Still on the wound control, I think this is just recent placenta. An umbilical placental membrane, people have been using it. This is an umbilical cord. Laser therapy, actually, we used it at one time in chronic ulcers. And I think this has got a place to use. This is done earlier. But I think when you have got these difficult wounds of loading plus something else. And VAC or negative pressure. Wound therapy or vacuum assisted closure. This is actually, we have one actually. The problem about the VAC, the patient has to have it at home probably. We don't have admission here. It has to be admitted. I think there is a good experience in the Shergenil. I really salute Dr. Mohamed. And I mean, I think they have put where they are. Now somebody is doing it actually on a private basis. But how does it work? I mean, the vacuum-assisted closure or negative pressure wound therapy. This is a continuous suction in some atmospheric pressure. Okay, you put a wound is closed and there is a sucker coming out, collecting these exudates. It's supposed to improve the blood flow. It reduces the exudate, reduces the inflammatory edema, inflammatory cells. Okay, and it promotes probably wound healing. The process. This is what I think it is. It is. Is there. There is now some mobile back around, but there is one thing to be careful about. If you close the wound there 2-3 days, I will be very reluctant in some critical wounds if they have got a necrotic tissue. If you put a back, the back has to be there, but it's not going to take the necrotic tissue. And if I get especially this pseudomonas, so it needs a wound that is oozing, but is not containing any tissues that has to be tried by AMI. I will come to that. You are in favor of the surgical debridement. As you see, the ultrasound debridement. There are different ways companies are competing for many ways of debridement. But I think in our wounds here, we found that the knife is the best, as safe as the one in Kutubi. Okay. Microbiological control. As I said, if it is a localized mild sepsis less than 3 centimeters, then here probably oral antibiotics first. If it is a systemic antibiotics, usually what we use, serial degradation. I said, I think on the next slide, probably. Yes, the protease and the coliforms. Coliforms are the commonest, except, I mean, in the European is usually staph. But as I said, the Pseudomonas, you have to be very careful about the Pseudomonas because you see this greenish stuff, and this has to be removed by sharp debridement on daily basis. And be very careful because they say that if it infects other people, it's one of the ways. And most likely to be sensitive to any case, this is what we found. The other thing is the mycelial resistant stuff. Okay. For how long do you use antibiotics? As I said, usually 2 to 3 weeks. In osteomyelitis, sometimes we go more than that, for 6 weeks, okay? But I think the guidelines will be here. This is a study by Mubarak. Mubarak now is taking in Jemena, did a great work. So we compare the white cell ESR and CRP, and we found that when the CRP, I mean the precalcitonin is being, we didn't do it here at home, but I think this is one of the criteria to tell you the activity of the sepsis. But in our study, we found that when the CRP comes to normality, it usually matches with the wound. The wound will be clean. We're not talking about healing of the wound. We're talking about a clean ulcer, okay? So when the clean ulcer and the other indices are normal, you can stop the antibiotics. I mean, this is a matter probably of loading and other things. People here tend to use these antibiotics for a very long time. I think this has to be very careful because what we did is related to the clinical grading with this laboratory thing, and we found it probably very informative. I will just give you here some clinical scenarios. This is the last part of my talk, and I think this is the commonest. Patients come with blister. Please don't aspirate it. Don't pick it with the needle. People, they do sometimes with the sore, and this is because of the sepsis. Because if you leave it like this, it's going to break anyway. I mean, absorption. This needs somebody who really, I mean, understands. You get the superficial ulcer, which is going to heal in just 2 weeks. The same thing. So be like this. A blister should always be cleaned and dressed, and probably don't need to dress it every day. Usually it heals. If you leave it, you're going to get sepsis like this. I mean, this is a blister, and you can see the cellulitis. Now we have got now infected blister with cellulitis, and this is the antibiotic. I think it's important. Sometimes you don't find any ulcer. Just you find one of the toes, especially usually the big toe, is bigger than the others. Sometimes almost the double size. And you can guarantee if you do an X-ray, as you can see here, you get an osteomyelitis. So there are two scenarios. If there is an ulcer, a small pinhole ulcer, you can put your artery forceps and get some of these bone fragments. I mean, the sequestrum will be really easy to take and send it for culture, and this patient will need antibiotics for at least probably 6 weeks. Sometimes you don't have a wound, and we give just an empirical antibiotic. If the patient is not fibroid, just big dose, you can give and observe and see how much they get the response to that. And I don't think, unless there is some probably bogus swelling that needs to be inside, but if it is not, then you don't need to make an incision. Yes, this is a big toe. You find sometimes just a small opening. I think one of the good process is just to squeeze. If you squeeze the foot, then an unseen small wounds might appear, and that you can send, put an artery forceps and open. And you might find that the whole bone has been eaten away. Don't amputate, please. Don't amputate those. Patients are coming every time asking about this. I receive many of these patients sometimes offer amputation. If the skin is necrotic, okay. But if the skin is healthy, don't need to remove the bone. I mean, this is a clean wound, as you can see here. And this can be later, I mean, when it granulates, it can be stitched. nobody's going to ask you whether this two has got a bone or hasn't got a bone. Psychologically, I mean, and we have a publication actually in the American Journal of Ankle and Joint of Ankle case of saving hallux. Look at this. Same thing, I mean, at the wound, we have just this tracking. You can see the X-ray, patient being cultured antibiotics, and it heals. Okay, we have got a lot of these healed toes without bones. Look at this. Be very careful. Those need an incision to make here. Once you open, if there is any necrotic tissue, has to be removed. Re-amputation. It's quite clear. I mean, you can see here. This is the sepsis where you need to do a re-amputation. And it heals very well. Tracking. I think sometimes you get this is the work of Dr. Khalid. I think a very good work. The work on the dorsal ulcer. And sometimes, I mean, if you have got a plantar ulcer, be careful there is no extension to the dorsal. And if there is a dorsal, most likely it will traverse the joint, sometimes ankle joint, or probably just a tarsal bones. But I think this patient usually have got an osteomyelitis, take a culture antibiotics, and we put these gauze temporarily, and then we remove it. Stitching, I think Fikri in the United States has did this. Well, be careful. I won't advise stitching for everybody. I think I have to be very careful, and this is not the one we do. We do stitching probably in the lower part here, because as you can see, this is an extended wound. Don't worry about the extended wound. I mean, be careful if you have got a wound extending sometimes as the tendon Achilles, remove the tendon Achilles if it's infected. And we got actually, yes, published it again in the wound care, the leg extension. As with very good results, I think we don't have probably one or two amputation. But usually you stitch here at the ankle and leave that. If there is any track, you wait, and we did interrupt the stitches. And this just reminds me sometimes when we do the first debridement, we debride in a way that we can stitch to avoid skin graft. And we put probably sutures far away so that the two edges can be probably brought together. But I don't think this should be safe for everybody. I think this is no way. You cannot really stitch it. Most likely this would be the skin graft. Dorsum ulcer. Here. Be careful, actually. Pure dorsal ulcer, usually you lose your toes here in young patients because of cellulitis or high pressure and digital vasculitis. Yeah. I think if you do just an incision to release the pressure, you can save these toes. I mean, it's not a common. I mean, pure dorsal diabetic ulcer is not common. But I think in the Khalid series, they have got very good results, actually. But if you neglect it, then you can lose the toes. Heel ulcers. I think also we have a series of heel ulcers published also with the ankle and joint. This is more serious, I think. Be very careful about the heel ulcer, and it has to be actually probed, debrided as early as possible because it's one of the serious ulcers that might end with amputation. Chronic ulcers. These are the ulcers going for years and years. Look at this. I think this is the one which we probably need cast. As I said, cast is used for charcoal and for chronic ulcer. I think in charcoal, we used to use it for a short while, but now I think as Abu Bakr, with Abdullah is working on this, now we use cast for a long time, more than 6 weeks. Or so. But now he's using a removable cast because people don't like any a complete cast. But this sort of ulcers, I'm sure you are going to get some degree of osteomyelitis, but as you can see, the foot looks all right. So this will need offloading. Well, this is just a visit to our center in Jabir, Abu Luis, which 1998. Now we're going to celebrate. This is the entrance, as you can see. Well, the idea of the, it is a multidisciplinary service. As I say, I mean, the diabetic foot cannot be part, cannot be separated from other. And this is what we had, actually. We have a medical clinic. We have a pediatric now is probably separate. But we have an ophthalmic. We have a dermatology. We have a dental. We have a nephrology, nutrition, pharmacy, lab. But the idea is that in Jabir is that the diabetic patient, when he comes, he has to visit all the other departments. And this is a new concept, because if the diabetic told him to go to the dentist, he said, I have no problem in my teeth. Why are you sending me there? Yes, we are sending you there because we don't want you to have problem. And we have a very good ophthalmology, actually, department, it's OCT. And we hope, actually, this will flourish for. But I think we have an obstetrician, but they need an ultrasound. So we are going to get an ultrasound. We hope we are going to accommodate obstetrician. The foot itself, you need to have this. I mean, besides the nursing, plastic surgeon, okay, we have patient education. I think probably might need an orthopedic. I think tomorrow we have some sort of microsurgical session. I will be looking very forward for this, probably diabetic foot with charcoal, because a lot of microsurgery is being done actually outside. We have the psychology, very good work actually, social worker. And then we have the wound care, as you see. And we have, actually what we are looking, no vascular, this is the problem. I think we are going to try to establish a vascular. We don't have an X-ray department as well, actually. It's one of the weak points we have. This is our dressing, as you can see. This is being named Ali Foster. I must say 2 words about Ali Foster. She died just a few years back. And she trained, actually, most of our staff. She visited us here. And she was actually planning to go to a fashion center celebration when we open it. But unfortunately, she just died before. Every time she sent me an email, when are you going to go to a fashion center? So we named this dressing room. There are 6 cubicles here for the infected wounds. We have got another 4 cubicles, and we have got 2 for Pseudomonas and Sicilian resistant. This is just probably a scene for the center. This is the education center. We do all our education to the staff, to the nurses and doctors. We have actually open centers in all. Or, and as you see, this is a personalized education in Jabir. I think this is a very important part, education, as I want to show you in the next slides. Just to see the... Well, this is important. I think this is work by Mohamed Abdullah. Mohamed, I think now he's doing bariatric surgery. Earlier on, between 2009-2012, okay, we did this foot care clinic. I mean, these patients who are diabetic, they have no problem with their feet, and they are coming every 3 or 6 months to have their feet checked, okay? So we chose, at that time, now we have more than 10,000, I think. But at that time, we have 2,500 patients. So we selected 624 patients who are regular for the last 4 years and who come for follow-up with a minimal of coming every 6 months to see the effect of education and food care. Does it really make any difference or not? Okay. So the patients were, mean age was 50, so they're not really young, plus minus 12. They are diabetic for 77% were diabetic for 5 years, and 60% has more than 4 sessions. So they really fulfill the criteria. 72% had more than 1 risk factor by this. As I showed you, the risk factor is the SS, the King's College criteria. Okay, 22% are high risk patients. And 24% has got ischemic symptoms. So look at this. Minor amputation was 3.5%. A major amputation were 2.9%. The way it figured at that time was, I think, around 1%. So we're not really far from it. So we can do it. I think people should concentrate on diabetics. We should have a foot care. This is what I actually, and I think should be the objective, is the preventive thing. Food care. This is our factory, and we are actually short of material. As I said, it's very expensive to get this material, and this is why the shoes cost a lot. And we hope that the insurance probably put it. We are negotiating this, that they will provide support to the patients, because it is really difficult for them. And well, lastly, I want indication for lower extremity amputation. There are absolute indication and relative indication, and I think outside, they should be taken by 2 people, a surgeon and a vascular surgeon. And I think people have to be very careful here. If you have both somebody an absolute indication, be careful. If young patients, I will be careful about that because I might give him a trial probably over the year if he hasn't gotten ischemia. But if I put an elderly patient who have got a chronic ulcer who has been going for a long time with comorbidity, dressing, blood transfusion, I think this could be negotiated better for the patient to have the amputation and a prosthesis instead of going on this, he's recumbent for the last 3 months, antibiotics is going to affect his kidneys. And I think that the family will have this feeling better amputation, but they want you to tell it. And I think this is an area that needs a lot of, practical actually. Yeah. The other thing, above knee or below knee, I usually, if the leg is completely black, but in most situations, I will tell the patient, I will start with the below knee and see. Otherwise I'll go for above knee. I know that you don't want to give the patient two procedures in elderly patients. But I tell you, I did a below knee in a patient whom I didn't even tie a single vessel, but the capillaries and the arterioles and the healthy granulation tissue, and it went very well. That was a professor actually, he died from my own. But I think amputation has to be taken, cautiously, sometimes clear, sometimes, and as you say, transfemoral arthritis is the new name for below knee and above the amputation. Well, for amputation, look at these chairs. We use these chairs to actually bring the patient inside. But I tell you, if you have got a below knee amputation patient, you want him to use a prosthesis, keep the chair away from him. And usually when I amputate a patient, after a while, I will tell him, I will never see you unless you come with the crutches. And then you have a long prosthesis. Because they found the chair. I know above knee amputation, usually, we have difficulties. But this is the fairest enemy to the amputee, is the wheelchair. Well, Martin Luther King said, I have a dream, and I have this dream. Khartoum Diabetic Center, this is the sixth floor map building, actually. Everything is ready. We just need less than $4 million. And I'm actually shopping now for these Berlin donors. I'm trying to get, this has been going for the last 5 years, and I'm trying to get funding for it. And I hope that this is going to accommodate everybody. I've got a vascular, we have got hyper, everything. I think that will be really a good move if it is successful. Well, thank you very much, and hoping if you have got any comments or discussion from the audience. I thank Muhammad here, Muhammad Abbas, Khalid, helping us because we have our couple. But they have been very to secure that this session will continue. Thank you.
Alhamdulillah, إنها تمت. قطعت الكهرباء كانت يعني في وقت very critical. أنا ما عرفت إنها هم مثلاً ما عرفت الحاصل شنو. بس فجأة كده قطع وبقينا برا الموضوع خالص يعني.
Anyone have any comment? Muhammad Ali, you're
welcome. I have one question. I work with you during my rotation. I want you to tell us about a technical aspect of your rotation. مثلا using of the term in a diabetic patient ولا just cutting life topic لانه بتمشي من حته لحته و see a lot يعني في ناس بيوز the term a lot in a diabetic patient ليش كده؟
not very clear.
Any difference of the اي
I can't hear you very well. Can you just repeat the question please?
بالنسبه للtechnical aspect of doing amputation.
Yes.
Using of the hand in a diabetic leg.
Yeah.
Any problem or precautions, مثلاً, technically?
Well, I think if you are going to go through the knee and it is edematous, sometimes, in young patients, I wouldn't mind. I tell him that I'm going to go below knee, but you're not going to get a healing. You are going to get partially open. Okay. I always, if the patient has got a good pulsations, I think it is unfair to do an above knee amputation, especially in young patients. And you can tell the patient, so you can make an amputation, probably you can leave it semi-open, I wouldn't leave it completely open, just make stitches, And after 2 or 3 days, everything will settle, edema will, and then you come and do stage stitching. Thank you. For young patients, always a trans tibial is better. In ischemic patients, nothing just below knee or above knee, unless you have got a vascular. If there is a vascular interruption, then you might be able to do these 4 foot amputations. Just one thing, I think, for anesthesia, I think most of these patients have got anesthesia. Please try Ferris to test and see how much you can do. A lot of amputation, I think, in Jabir, even 4 foot sometimes can be done. But because I am neuropathic, of course, you don't, I mean, be careful about the pain, but I think a lot of procedure can be done even by ankle block.
Thank you, Professor, for this very nice presentation. I have a question about the phenomenon of acute develop in diabetic patients.
Okay, this is what you call as the acute attack. Somebody who is, you are seeing the patient and suddenly he comes with a very fulminating sepsis, you mean this?
Yes.
Yeah, I think this has been described. I usually always think if you get a surprise in a diabetic foot, mana, you are missing something. It's always I say this. Until last year, I think there is a very nice article by Professor Michael Edmond, and he called it the acute attacks. I'll send you the abstract. And I had actually, I had one case like this because so the patient 3 days, nothing. And then suddenly he got this flare-up. Explanation is difficult. Is it immunity low or is it probably the bacteria that has been, you have got the resistant bacteria, small amounts start to multiply and then suddenly you get this. It's very difficult actually to explain because somebody who was doing fine and suddenly, it's not a common thing. Because as I said, always if you have got a surprise, you look. And the surprise can be actually due to, the diabetic patient to be actually, you are in control. It means that you yourself to see the patient every day. Because if he has got any dressing anywhere, that might be a catastrophe. And we had an experience in home dressing. Because as we teach this, you cannot do a dressing on your own. There must be minimal of 2 people. Because once you wear these gloves, then you cannot touch anything. And I'm sorry to tell you that, I'm not going to talk about this hospital, private hospital, but go and ask any nurse to do the dressing and just stay and look. And you see their prices. People still don't realize that. Once you wear the gloves, then you cannot touch anything except the sterile. So you have to have the towel sterile. But this is not the
case. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Thank you for this nice presentation. How about using dithermy in amputation in diabetic patients?
For amputation, I never use tourniquet and I never use dithermy. The 2 things, I don't think you need them. And even a drain, I don't use a drain. Really, you utilize the vessels and you make hemostasis and you make sure there is no dead place. Especially, you do the long flap, the posterior flap, which comes forwards and covers it because this is the most weight-bearing area. I think the posterior flap is the most important thing. But I never use the dithermy, I never use a tourniquet. And I think just tying vessels and seeing the wounds and frequent activity. Sometimes, you get probably just a devitalization of the skin. Don't pull the skin, the skin has to come at ease. Muscle has to come at ease. There should be no tension actually. Probably for an above knee, you have to be careful because the muscle around the femur will be floppy around. So be careful so that you can fix the muscle so that it won't have a floppy type of stump that is the bone, and then you have got a lot of redundant tissues.
Welcome, Mr. Mohamed.
Assalamu alaikum, Professor Rasheed. كيف أحوالك? Very nice lecture. Really enjoyed it and learned a lot as usual. Inshallah, one day we'll be part of this Khartoum Diabetic Center. It's really something that's much needed. in the assessment of below knee or above knee amputation, we have been assessing the blood flow by doing pulse volume recording, PVR. I'm not sure if it's available for Sudan, like, and it's a very simple machine. We can work together in adding it to the center, inshallah. It's a very simple machine that measures waveforms at the level of the below knee segment and above knee segment, and it helps to tell who would heal a below knee amputation mm-hmm. from vascular standpoint and who would.
That's great. That will be a great addition.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Thank you very much. I think this is will be very helpful because, I mean, this is an area where, as you said, as I said, I mean, we don't want to do a below knee and come after another 2 weeks and do above knee. I mean, this is really a big burden to the patient.
Yes, sir. Absolutely. We'll do that. We'll work offline together, inshallah, on this.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Welcome, Yusuf. Yusuf Ali. Now you can ask your question, Yusuf Ali.
To join. Join.
I would like to ask about if there is for in the ischemic leg there is a line of demarcation. It is helpful Doppler ultrasound or proceed for amputation. And the other question about the using of in our hospital, we using sphinx as a replace of VEC. What about VEC system? What about this technique?
يوسف ممكن تسأل السؤال كان عربي لأن السؤال ما واضح.
ما واضح.
يسأل من الباك مسيس.
الباك. I think for the ischemic, if you have got a line of demarcation, I think you take in consideration many other things. The age of the patient, okay? And there is no vascular intervention that could be done. And have you got a really a palpable popliteal artery? So I think the, as I said, the balance between, you don't want to do two procedures within short time, especially elderly patient if there is a comorbidity. But for a young patient, I think they can stand it. I mean, I wouldn't mind to gamble on a young patient because usually probably it is just aseptic. And even, I mean, sometimes this is what they call as a fulminating septic that you do an emergency amputation. I think many of these patients probably a major debridement. I mean, I'm not talking about a neuropathic with good circulation. And probably this is just being neglected. Your second question was about, is it about back, is it?
Yes, yes.
The back, we have no experience actually in the back, actually. We have the back with us, but it is expensive. It is a consumable or expensive, this material. But and you need actually to keep it with the patient at home. But I know there is somebody who is doing mobile. One of the sisters with somebody, they can do this for the patients. I think it has got a place, but I don't think, I mean, it has got earlier on, everybody was talking about back. Now I think it is a little bit, I mean, I think with this, I mean, our problem at in center is that people has to come every day. Some people has to come every other day. And some people have, this is very expensive transport, as you know. People are actually renting all the houses around Jabir now. They're renting it rooms. Yesterday, I had this organization called Amal, they are trying to get us a place where they can actually accommodate these patients because it is very expensive just to come from a high UC or from an airport dressing. Taking in consideration now that we have got actually, we train the health centers around Khartoum, not less than 250, I think, even up to Elafoun, I think, tomorrow or Tuesday, we're going to visit our center in Elafoun and Shergandi, Bukina. So this stuff now we have trained a lot of stuff of these nurses in these health centers. This has been funded by the World Diabetes Foundation in a project. And as you see, this education center, we bring the 12 or 15 from each region and they stay for 1 month with us here. We pay for their transport, we pay for their education, we're feeding, everything. And this is thanks to the World Diabetes Foundation. I must realize they have funded us twice. Some fees was 450,000 euro and the other 200. And this is how we open actually this Fashir, Gadarif, Dongula, Lubayid, and all these centers with trained staff. And in Khartoum, actually, we have in Bahri. We didn't have in Bahri, actually, we have health centers in Bahri, in Durman. So now we try to get the patient when they have got a clean wound, please go to that center, I mean, specifically. And this is reduced. I mean, we used to see almost nearly 200 patients a day. Now we are seeing less than that, 50 and 60 patients a day, which is really a remarkable, I think, achievement. Thanks.
طيب الفرصة مفتوحة يا شباب لأي زول عنده سؤال محمد علي أمريكان
ذكر والدي والدي
بعد صوتك شوية
لما يرمبر والله يعني الوقت فيه من during the rotation وكده أنا remember one patient I will never forget patient كان عنده strong indication for amputation at that time very toxic very ill dehydrated did the ABCs patient كان hypertensive diabetic has some cardiac problem كان عندنا hesitant we were juniors كده كان جينا قلنا والله قص يا اخي this patient عنده كده 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 you said one word go and amputate I remember two times you said that and with the bus يعني كان كلامه go and amputate and we did the amputation Come very excellent dramatic response to the patient on the next day. Even had the patient can admit it to the ICU and 2-3 days can umuru kulla kuisa makan el bihayo ki. Lano tama lano we are registrars to the juniors. What are the special considerations regarding the juniors? يعني how to deal with these patients? من خبرتك من حياتك شفتها في الجلوس خصوصا في الحوالي.
قلت I tell you, I mean, many patients who refuse amputation, and then when you do an amputation, you will be surprised. He will tell you that, well, if I know I'm going to get relief like this, I would have done it long time ago. These are the chronic patients, I mean, who has got probably blood transfusion and things. But for the acute thing, I mean, the question would be saving the limb or saving the life? And this is really the question. I think this is now less, because as I told you, when I was a registrar, I face a lot of this, and I face, as I said, some of the patients who tell me, no, no amputation, let me die intact. They tell you this. And even when they accept it very late. But this is now less and less because of these services. But the question would be, as I said, I mean, is it a life saving or is it a limb saving? You want to, you might try to save the limb and lose the life. This is what I'm saying. So you take in consideration many things, as I said, the age of the patient, the comorbidity, the acceptance of the patient. The patient sometimes will be very reluctant. Other patients will be. So I think it is not one thing. It is a combination of many things. And as I tell you, I mean, this critical situation, you better consult. The decision has to be taken by more than one person, I think.
Mr. Firas. You are welcome.
Assalamu alaikum. Actually, I don't have any questions. I just only came here to see Professor Rasheed. I'm one of your students. I graduated 20 years ago, sorry. أنا دفعة ناس شيراز وأحمد الضو مختار ولا شباب أبدال. I'm very happy to see you on board.
Nice, thank you. It's nice to hear about you. Where are you now?
والله أنا في لندن حالياً بروف.
I see.
أنا شغال upper GI surgery وبعمل bariatrics و upper GI mainly.
I see. One of our hobbies, upper GI.
Exactly. Yeah. الحمد لله.
Thank
nice
you very
to
much.
See you. Nice to see you, bro.
Thank you.
Yusuf Ahmed, you're welcome.
Assalamu alaikum, Prof. Rasheed.
Yeah,
my question is about sometimes we found that some patients have a crepitus with gas-forming organism, but without blackish discoloration. So it's not a gas gangrene, but gas-forming organism. How can we deal with it? Some people think it is a genuine indication for amputation to have a gas-forming organism.
Very good question, I think. I was waiting somebody to ask this question because I think there is over probably diagnosis. Now we don't see it by manner. But I think you have to be very careful because gas-forming bacteria, as you said, the differentiation between the two. I think the clinical picture is very important. I mean, the clinical picture, the patient is drowsy, the patient is toxic, the age of the patient, the crepitus is probably, but I had a case actually, and I did a below knee and I did above knee, and actually I thought I'm going to lose the patient, but he's a young patient, he could tolerate it. Almost, yes, above knee. Now, but as I said, I mean, if the patient is young and is not toxic, I think the clinical picture is important for you, as I probably say, being described by our young colleague before, the case I think here, you need really, I mean, very difficult to just put lab studies. I mean, you can get a very high OICL, get high CRP, you get this crepitus. But I think I'll be very careful if the crepitus is above the knee. If the knee is swollen and there is a crepitus above the knee, then this has to be careful because if it creeps up to the abdomen, then you lose your patient. And I think probably as this life-saving, I mean, taking consideration the other aspects, toxicity, I would definitely go for an above knee amputation for such a case.
لو في أي زول عنده سؤال يا جماعة ممكن نعمل ميوت لنفسه. مستر فكري يا ويلكم.
I just have a comment. As vascular surgeons, we're very aggressive revascularizing all the diabetic patients with ischemic ulcers. Lakin, when it comes to small vessel disease, when it comes to vasculopathy below the level of the ankle, hyperbaric therapy seems to be very helpful. It's part of the armamentarium for extensive wound care in general, or diabetic septic foot especially. We, as you know, distribution of disease in diabetic is mostly tibial disease. Nowadays, we aggressively do balloon angioplasties for them. And if they have a long segment of multi-level disease, we do inflow work like Professor Rasheed showed, the iliac interventions, and then we do long distal bypasses. When we revascularize everything and the wound chronically doesn't heal and we control the infection, control all the other risk factors, offload and everything, hyperbaric therapy seems to help those patients and improve the limb salvage rate. There are different types of chambers and it's very well regulated here. Like, in hopefully one day we have hyperbaric therapy in Sudan.
You have it for the chamber or just for the foot? Because now I can see these machines which just keep the hyperbaric or locally for the foot only.
Yes, sir. So, yeah, mostly chambers. We have we have a chamber here where people come in every day for a month. They spend an hour or two in a hyperbaric chamber.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it improves the healing rate for those patients.
Which is better? I mean, the whole chamber, the whole patient inside, or just the limb?
The whole chamber has more evidence to support. There's a lot of, because the data from the small little machines is industry driven. It's hard to validate, and it's
The other question is that what is the relation between the radiologists who do angioplasty and the vascular who they do bypass? And when do you to decide to do a bypass? When do you decide just an angioplasty? And the second thing is that you go by the catheter, do you reach even the dorsalis pedis? And are the cardiologists also involved? Because we have a problem, we have only three, but I mean, the vascular surgeon and the radiologists are not actually, everybody is doing his own work.
Absolutely, Professor. I think this is a key question. So the as you know, endovascular surgery, endovascular interventions was invented by interventional radiologists. But because they don't have the big picture and they don't have the relationship with the patients, vascular surgeons took over very quickly and adopted this about 20 years ago. The cardiologists, they have the skills because they do the coronary interventions. Yeah. So they also got into it. Right now here in the US, the cardiologists do it, radiologists do it, but the vascular surgeons do it better than everybody because they do both open and endo. So they offer, and they have literature. The vascular literature is very extensive in different outcomes between balloon angioplasty, stenting, atherectomy, combination of all those. So the cardiologists and the radiologists, they tend to just do interventions. The vascular surgeons, they don't tend to do more durable interventions. They can switch between open and endo depending on the patient need. With the catheter-based interventions, we go all the way down to the arch of the foot. We can open all the way down to the arch of the foot. Now we can access even the posterior tibial and the anterior tibial as an access site, and we go retrograde. The interventions can involve the arch. It cannot involve smaller vessels than the arch. Deciding when to do open bypass, when to do endo, usually when the patient comes in, we do risk stratification. Like you said in the lecture, obviously we evaluate the heart, the lungs, the kidneys, and we risk assess the patient and how much surgical intervention the patient can tolerate. And then we do vein mapping as well as a conduit for bypasses, because as you know, veins do better than synthetic grafts. And then we do CT angiogram or catheter-based interventions after the ABI PVR. And then we look at everything. We look at the anatomy of disease, the function of disease, the capacity for the patient to tolerate open versus endo. And then we create a plan based considering everything. We tend to consider the most durable with the least risk. And then there is hybrid approach where we do both. Patient comes in, they have iliac stenosis, they have common femoral disease, and they have occlusion of the SFA, popliteal, and the tibial. We open the groin, clean the common femoral, we do femoral anatrectomy, go retrograde and stent the iliac, and then create a bypass.
My question, do you do selective? Because somebody who has got an ischemic heel ulcer, okay, or a big toe, and he has this, it's not successful because I'm interested in the blood supply to the heel. The toes are all right.
Right.
So yes. I don't know whether do you really do selective arterial, depending on the ulcer site.
Yes. So yes. So the angiosomes, there's a lot of debate lately about does angiosomes matter or not, where the anterior tibial supply a different part of the foot versus the peroneal versus the posterior tibial. And I'm convinced that sometimes they are interconnected, and with only one tibial disease, tibial vessel, you can supply all the foot if there is enough collateralization between the three. Diabetic patients specifically, they have very poor collateralization between the three. We see patients with heel ulcer and they have excellent dorsal pedis, but then they don't have posterior tibial. The posterior tibial would be occluded. You check their ankle brachial index is normal because the anterior tibial is normal. But then we go and we open the posterior tibial with balloon angioplasty or atherectomy, the wound heals like this very fast. So we do selective intervention, especially in diabetic patients, because there is poor collateralization between different angiosomes.
Yeah, I can see that intervention radiologists are actually creeping everywhere. They are not going to the prostate and blocking, so probably the urologist will be out of action soon. And the obstetrician also are blocking things, the fibroids. So they are everywhere now, I think. It's a specialty that needs really. Mm-hmm.
Absolutely, they are everywhere. They invented it, but they.
Can continue, Mr. Thank you very much, Professor Rasheed, for this very informative and thorough discussion. And we hope to see you next time.
to discuss a lot of issues related to diabetic foot. We hope tomorrow we have a very nice topic about microsurgical reconstruction in diabetic foot. Will be presented by one of the eminent surgeons from India. Till tomorrow, thank you very much, Professor Rasheed. Thank you all of the participants, and we hope to see you tomorrow. Shukran jazeeran, Professor.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Mohamed. It was a great idea. Okay, I think, as I said,